Hello, everyone, and welcome to Module 3 of the Healthy Lifestyle Program, Maintaining Energy Balance. If this is your first time joining us, my name is Natalie Lascano. I'm the Wellness Coordinator with UF Communications and Work Life, and I am the presenter for this program. So our objectives for this module are to recognize healthy body composition, learn the basics of energy balance, and apply energy balance principles to maintaining a healthy weight. So first off, what is body composition? Body composition refers to the different percentages of fat, bone, and muscle in our bodies and is used to determine if we are at a healthy weight for our body and our needs. Two people with the same height and weight could have drastically different health outcomes because of their different body compositions. It is important to note that body composition is highly dependent on factors such as genetics, age, sex, and activity levels. For example, women and men tend to have very different percentages of fat and muscle. Women tend to have more essential fat than men. They have about 12% essential fat, as opposed to men who have only 3% of essential fat, because fat is necessary for pregnancy, childbirth, and breastfeeding. Men, on the other hand, have more muscle tissue than women. They typically have 45% muscle tissue, whereas women only have 36%, because in the days of our very distant ancestors, men were responsible for hunting and fighting off attacks, which required more muscle. So you'll notice that the distribution of bone and organs are essentially equal between the two sexes because there was no evolutionary advantage to men and women. And you also notice that the chart does show a difference between essential fat and non-essential fat. Essential fat is that which is used in necessary body functions such as pregnancy in women and organ insulation in both sexes, whereas non-essential body fat is used as energy storage. So it is essential in the idea that we need to have some of it at least to access as energy storage, because that is what our body taps into when we are experiencing shortages in food. But because our lifestyles have changed so drastically since the days of our caveman ancestors, people who lead sedentary lifestyles tend to have more non-essential fat than our body absolutely needs as an energy reserve. And so this was not an issue for our prehistoric ancestors because the stresses of their lives required them to constantly be active in finding food, shelter, and water. But since our lives now require long periods of sitting at a desk or in a car, and food is essentially always available, we don't have to go out and hunt our own food. Our bodies now have more non-essential fat stores than they evolved to hold. So this incongruence between how we live and how our bodies were designed to live causes a lot of health complications such as cardiovascular disease and diabetes. And if you're curious about your own body composition and calculating that, you can visit the UF Sport Performance Center there. The link is on this slide. You can also just Google UF Sport Performance Center body composition, and they have several resources to help you calculate your body composition. They do have a fee associated with them, but the fee is very minimal compared to what you may pay at a different private institution. All right, so now moving on into energy balance. And what is energy balance? So energy balance is the comparison of calories consumed, which is our diet, versus calories expended or our activities levels. And to some extent, our body composition does depend on our behavior and our resulting energy balance. But your body composition also influences your energy balance. So it's kind of a feedback loop that happens. So for example, those with more muscle than fat will require more calories just in a resting state than those with more fat than muscle, because muscle tissue just naturally requires more calories just to maintain itself. And it is important to note that physical activity is not the only way our bodies burn off calories. You expend calories just by breathing, digesting, and thinking. And our bodies do need calories to perform every molecular function that occurs in our cells just to keep us alive. I think there is a conception that calories are a bad thing. Calories are not a bad thing. Calories are essential. And that leads me into what is a calorie? The calorie is just another word for energy. It is a type of unit we use to measure the amount of energy stored in a particular food, the same way that we would measure distance in miles. It is what we use as the basis of the concept of energy balance. Our bodies use calories to accomplish all the molecular tasks of daily living that we talked about earlier. And any calories that are not used do not just go away. They are stored as that non-essential fat we spoke about in the previous slides. And as we touched on briefly in Module 2, we get different amounts of calories from each macronutrient. So the three macronutrients are fat, protein, and carbohydrates. If you hear the term micronutrient anywhere, that refers to things such as minerals and vitamins, which we also get from our food, but serves a different primary purpose than providing energy. So as you can see here on this slide, we get 4 calories from each gram of protein and carbohydrates. So protein and carbohydrates provide us the same amount of energy. However, we get 9 calories per each gram of fat, which means fats are a great source of energy when our bodies are in a pinch. This is why our excess calories we consume are transformed into fat in our bodies and stored as that non-essential fat. Because if we are ever in a situation where our food was limited, our bodies would be able to get more energy from each gram of stored fat than they would from muscle or other tissue. So this actually helps us to keep us alive longer in a stressful situation until we can find food again. And as I mentioned earlier, stored fat is also easier for our bodies to maintain than muscle. So those are the reasons why our body stores those excess calories as fat. And so there are many ways to track the energy that we get in, the primary one being reading the nutrition label on your food. Nutrition labels do look a little different now from the one shown here, but I'm using this image because of the way it outlines good rules of thumb to keep in mind for each part of the nutrition label. So starting at the top, we'll take a look at the serving size for the food we are about to eat, which on this diagram, it says it's mac and cheese. And so the information listed below that serving size is the amount for that portion rather than the whole container. So notice how much the serving size is and how many servings are in the container. If you want to eat more of that food than one serving size, then you can multiply the amount you plan to eat to get an idea of the amount of calories and other nutrients you will get from that food. And so then moving on from the top, you can see how many calories you'll get from that serving, and then you should investigate further to see how many of those calories come from fats, specifically saturated fats versus unsaturated fats. Remember from our previous module that saturated fats are not always bad for you necessarily, but you should limit the amount of saturated fat you eat, especially if you are trying to lose weight. So if more than half of the fats in a particular food come from saturated fat, it may be best to avoid buying that option and maybe find an alternative. Trans fats, on the other hand, are always bad for your health and were actually banned in the US since 2018. That's how bad they are. So you should always see a zero next to trans fat on the nutrition label. It's not shown on this diagram again. This diagram is a bit older, but if you see a nutrition label in the store, it should always say zero. And if for whatever reason it does not say zero, then do not buy that food. Do not eat that food. Under fat, you will also see the amounts for cholesterol and sodium, which should also be limited. So some cholesterol is better for you than other cholesterol. So HDL cholesterol is better for you, whereas LDL cholesterol is not necessarily as good for you. So again, that worse cholesterol that's not as beneficial comes from saturated fat. So if you are limiting your amount of saturated fat, and your amount of cholesterol, you should be pretty good. And too much sodium is also dangerous to our heart health as it increases our blood pressure. So sodium should also be limited. You'll also notice that sugars are included on the nutrition label, and although the diagram does not have it, most nutrition labels will also list the number of added sugars that are included in that product. So if you are trying to lose weight, then you should also try to limit the number of added sugars you consume. And those nutrients on the nutrition label that you should seek more of, on the other hand, are fiber, protein, and the listed vitamins and minerals. Fiber and sugar are listed together underneath the number of carbohydrates because they are both forms of carbohydrates. Fiber is good for our health, both for our heart and our digestive health, and fiber helps us to feel fuller longer. So you should seek out foods that are high in fiber. It also helps with your digestion and keeping you regular. You may also remember from the previous module that naturally occurring sugars are okay, but added sugars are not. So again, just limit the number of added sugars you consume. And so if you see that on the nutrition label that the added sugar is more than half the sugar or just seems like too much, try to find a different alternative. Protein is also good for you and essential in all body functions. So the more protein in a food, the better. The exact vitamins and minerals listed on the nutrition label at the bottom underneath protein will vary depending on the food. But in general, you should try to vary which vitamins and minerals you are getting from your food instead of only eating foods high in vitamin C, for example. Current nutrition labels also list the exact amount of vitamins and minerals included in a food rather than just the daily value percentages, which leads me into what the daily value percentages are. So if you see on the side here, there are those percents, and these indicate what percent of each nutrient you will get from eating that food that you should get in a day. For example, here it lists 18% next to total fat, meaning you'll get 10% of your total daily fat needs from eating this one serving of mac and cheese. Keep in mind that these daily values refer to a 2,000 calorie diet, which may not be accurate for each person. Your calorie needs depend on your lifestyle and your health goals, but a good rule of thumb is that 5% or less is low for that daily value, whereas 20% or more is high for that daily value. And so as we talked about earlier, our bodies use up calories just by existing, even when we are doing nothing, when we're doing things that we don't think require a lot of energy. In fact, about 70% of our daily calorie consumption is devoted to our normal bodily functions and normal activities. Of course, when we are doing something that requires more energy, like exercising, we use more calories than when we're just sitting at our desk. The number of calories our bodies use for each activity depends on several factors, such as the type of activity, amount of activity, and how much we weigh, and how that weight is distributed between body components. Again, muscle tissue is going to need more calories just to maintain than fat tissue. All right, and we can also use some scientific data to make general estimates of how many calories we need in a day. Though again, this is going to vary from person to person, so don't take this as an exact science because it's not. So these general estimates are listed here in this table based on age and sex, as well as activity level. And generally, as we get older, you'll see that our caloric needs will decrease because our bodily functions are just naturally beginning to slow down. And then males also tend to have larger calorie counts because, again, of that greater muscle mass that they have. So we can see here on this chart that for a male between the ages of 21 and 25, if they are sedentary, they'll need about 2,400 calories a day, whereas if they are active, they'll need about 2,800 calories a day, whereas females of the same age, if they're sedentary, they'll need 2,000 calories, or if they're active, they'll need 2,200 calories. So it's a full 400 calories less than males. But again, this is not an exact science, it's just a generalization. And so another way to measure our daily caloric needs is through our resting metabolic rate, or RMR, which calculates the number of calories we need in a day just to exist without any physical activity whatsoever. So when we are in a resting state, just as the name implies, this is how many calories our body would need just to keep our heart pumping, our eyes blinking, our brain thinking for the whole day. And again, this is also impacted by the various factors we spoke about earlier. But again, here we do see a general range based on height and sex. And so if you want to calculate what your RMR is, you can follow this equation. And then if you can also determine what your calorie needs if you get little to no exercise, or if you get intense exercise, you play sports, you have a physical job, you can write down this equation But there are also calculators available online that will do this for you. All right, so what does all of that even mean? It basically means that your weight is determined by the balance between the food that you eat, your calories in, and your activity or your calories out. So we can see here in the middle of this diagram, our weight will stay the same when our calories in equals our calories out. So if our calories consumed are equal to our calories expended, we are going to maintain the same weight. And then you will gain weight if the calories in are higher than our calories out. So either the calories in have increased or the calories out have decreased or both, and you're gaining weight. And then you will lose weight if the calories in are lower than calories out, increased, or both, and that causes you to lose weight. There's kind of a lot more that goes into this. It is important to remember that food and activity work together, determine how much we weigh. But there's also other factors that will impact whether we are able to lose weight and how quickly we're able to lose weight, and also how we maintain our weight. But the general idea is to tip the balance so that we are expending more calories than we are eating. And so in general, people tend to start gaining weight when they begin decreasing their activity levels as they get older, but still eating the same amount. And that typically leads to the weight gain that many people experience later on in life. So in general, the best way to tip the balance toward losing weight is to decrease our food intake, increase activity. So it is generally recommended that people who are not as close to their weight loss goal to aim to lose 2 pounds per week, and the people who are closer to their weight loss goal lose 1 pound a week. However, no one should eat fewer than 1,200 calories a day, and I would say that's even a low estimate. I don't think you should ever be eating less than 2,000 calories a day. Generally, you're going to want to stay around that 2,000 calorie range. Also, you do not want to just try a lose weight quick diet. Those never work. First of all, they're never they can never be maintained. You're just going to end up gaining the weight back. But it can also mean that if you're losing large amounts of weight quickly, it can mean that the water you're actually losing more water and muscle than fat, which is very unhealthy. And this, please also know that this doesn't mean that you should eat less or starve yourself. It's really more important that you eat less of the wrong foods, such as like processed foods, junk foods, fast foods, and eat more fruits and vegetables and lean proteins, which by default will decrease your calories, because whole foods and leaner proteins are going to have less calories than fast food. That's just by default going to decrease your calories, even if you're eating the same amount. So that's already going to contribute to weight loss or weight maintenance. And then just exercising a little bit more will just contribute to that more. But by no means should you try to get on some lose weight quick diet or some very extreme diet. That is not the recommendation here. Just be more mindful of what you are eating. So in general, about every 1 pound of body fat stores about 3,500 calories. And so to lose weight, we have to reduce the number of calories we take in, like we just talked about. And again, slow, steady weight loss is the best way to lose body fat instead of those quick weight loss diets that never work. So about 1 to 2 pounds per week is great. However, it's going to take some time to see changes in your weight. And you shouldn't be discouraged if you don't see changes in the mirror or on the scale within the first few weeks or even months. Again, even though I'm presenting numbers here, the actual functions that occur in our bodies are much more complex than these simple equations and are influenced by so many factors, even including the bacteria in our gut. So instead of a number, I encourage you to focus more on other changes you may experience as a result of your better eating habits, your better physical activity habits, such as increased energy, better sleep, and improved productivity. I really don't want to create an unhealthy relationship for you with food. That's not what the point of this module was. The this module is more meant to give you an understanding of how your body works and why your body was built the way that it is. And so there are some online tools you can use to help with your weight loss journey or your weight maintenance journey. These include MyFitnessPal, Fitbit, Google Fit, S Health, which is on the Samsung phones, the Health app on all iPhones, and the Super Tracker, which was created by the USDA and the US Department of Agriculture. Okay, so our take-home messages. So today we learned that calorie is just another word for energy, and we need energy for our bodies to properly function. And we learned that excess calories are stored as fat and therefore impact our body composition. Energy balance is just the balance of calories consumed versus calories expended. And energy balance can help to dictate weight loss, gain, or maintenance. Okay, so in the next module, we are going to discuss better sleep. But until then, I encourage you to create new SMART goals related to energy balance based on what you learned in this module. And see you next time.